Thank you, Lord, your precious Son to us. We love you this morning, Jesus. We love you. We honor you this morning, Lord. Boy, it's just so hard when you see so many empty seats, but how many believe that our loved ones will be back with us? Now, they're your loved ones, whether you believe it or not. We're all part of the same family. How many know that? So when they're born, we miss them, right? Well, you sound exuberant about that. But anyway, that's the truth. And it's so good to have all of you with us and back with us. And many that are born, we just pray God will keep them. Even one of my sons was on vacation. And yesterday, he said, Dad, he said, vacation started this morning. And he said, I'm telling you, I am as happy as I can be. And I said, well, I'm not too happy because I'm off vacation. But I said, think about me. He says, if I get time, Dad, I'll think of it. Well, praise God. We want to remember Wanda Yerker that's in prayer. I know she's not been very well. And we just happen to think of her, so we want to remember her in prayer. Just for your knowledge to know about and pray about, next Sunday morning, if God wills, and we're all here and I'm here, I'd like to preach on the subject of unexpectedly, instantaneously surprised at His authority. Unexpectedly, instantaneously surprised at His authority. That's next Sunday morning in the AM service. Then next Sunday night, we have the greens. If you have your Bibles, turn with me, if you would, to the book of Jeremiah. The book of Jeremiah, chapter 5.
Oh, you need to save me.
Find a man, if there be any that executeth judgment, that seeketh the truth, and I will pardon it. And though they say the Lord liveth, surely they swear falsely. O Lord, are not thine eyes upon the truth? Thou hast stricken them, but they have not grieved. Thou hast consumed them, but they have refused to receive correction. They have made their faces harder than a rock, and they have refused to return. Therefore I said, surely these are poor, and they are foolish, for they know not the way of the Lord, nor the judgment of their God. Verse 5. I will get me unto the great men, and will speak unto them, for they have known the way of the Lord, and the judgment of their God. But these have altogether broken the yoke, and have burst the bonds, and they have left, I paraphrase, and they have left also their God. Heavenly Father, bless your word this morning, and make it real unto our hearts, I pray. God, you've given me this message, and I pray I can impart it unto our people, as well as you have given it unto me. Anoint me with the Holy Spirit, and cover me with your blood. Lord, whoever may be listening to this on the radio or in our congregation, may their hearts be open unto the Holy Spirit to receive. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Someone wrote, I looked upon a farm one day that once I used to own. The barn had fallen to the ground. The fields were overgrown. The house in which my children grew, where we had lived for years, I turned to see it broken down and brushed aside the tears. I looked upon my soul one day to find it too had grown with thorns and nettles everywhere, the seeds neglect had sown. The years had passed while I had cared for things of lesser worth. The things of heaven I let go while minding things of earth. To Christ I turned with bitter tears and cried, O Lord, forgive. I have not much time left for thee, not many years to live. The wasted years forever gone, the days I can't recall. If I could live those days again, I'd make you Lord of all. May God help us this morning to take it to heart. This is one of the most startling messages in the entire Bible. My theme this morning, when self-will challenges divine authority. It is part of a message which was to be declared in the house of Jacob and published throughout all of Israel. It shows to all generations the inevitable results when self-will challenges the rule of God. The prevailing issue of our time is, who is going to be God, us or him? Humanism and materialism call for self to be in charge. So today, let me leave and take you from the perspective of last Sunday's message of praise and worship. to that of responsibility. Humanism and materialism are the creed for the day. But the Bible declares that the Lord, He is God. And sir, lady, as we Christians ultimately decide this question, we will decide it by our faith, and we will decide it by our actions. The prophet Jeremiah is one of the most colorful figures to walk across the pages of Bible history. His very name invokes within us the idea of trouble and lamentations. Every time we read his words, we sort of get a lump in our throat when we realize the difficulty he had as he preached. I've been here in October 26 years. He preached in Israel for 25 years. And according to history, he never had one convert. Not one. But he continued to preach what God told him to preach. He continued to tell Israel what God wanted Israel to hear. And I believe he is so very human, Jeremiah, that most of us can readily identify with him. We watch him go from periods of great joy to deep depression in a very short period of time. He was overwhelmed by an exhausted nation that had come to a disregard for God in its daily affairs. The priests were ruling by their own authority. And the people had forgotten God and hewed cisterns in the sand and spurned God's forgiveness. It reminds me of what's happening today in America. Our Supreme Court has got to the point that they rule by their own authority. And thus, it isn't important anymore what our creed or law says or what our country stands on. Whatever they decide is what we have to do. And we don't have much choice. We need to pray that God will touch the leadership of our country and cause them to feel the need to walk a road that is holy and upright as our country was first started upon. Worst of all, in our text today, they loved the country of Israel. They loved the condition that they were in. Somebody has said, you can tell the sheep are in trouble when the shepherd starts speaking kindly of the wolf. Remember that. The sheep are in trouble when the shepherd starts speaking kindly of the wolf. Folks, today when self-will challenges divine authority, there will always be terrible consequences. Let's look at this text in the book of Jeremiah today in chapter 5. First of all, there was a lack of reverence or a lack of awe of God. Jeremiah chapter 5, our text, verses 12 through 14 says, and they belied the Lord and said, it is not he, neither shall evil come upon us, neither shall we see sword nor famine. And the prophets shall become wind, and the word is not in them. Thus shall it be done unto them. Wherefore, thus saith the Lord God of hosts, because the people speak this word, behold, I will make my words in thy mouth fire, and this people wood, and it shall devour them. In other words, this people shall be devoured by their own words and consumed. You see, haven't you seen it in the world today? We used to believe that God was creator. We used to believe that he's the one that brought the springtime and the time of growth and then the harvest. And that whatever we had on our table to eat, we blessed and thanked him. Because if it were not for him, we would not have it. We would thank God in the morning when we got up to go to work, no matter whether we loved our job or we didn't. We thank God every morning for giving us a job so that we could make money to take care of our family. We thank God every night for the clothes we wear, for the bed we slept in, for the roof over our head. But today, it seems like the consensus of the world is, I'm the one who provides these things. If it wasn't for me, they would not be here. And you know what? It's called humanism. It has destroyed the very basics of religion in this country. Someone has said, the people did not deny the existence of God. They were too smart for that. They simply denied God's authority and said, we won't do anything about the way we're living. The battle for the soul is fought at this point, ladies and gentlemen. What rights does God have in my life? That's the battle that we're fighting today. How much right will we give God in our life? Our self-willed society does not want to dump God altogether. We just want to keep him at a comfortable distance. We want enough of God to keep our guilt above the threshold of pain, but not enough to disturb our prejudice. We want enough of God to fulfill our personal ambitions, but not enough to change our plans. We want enough of God to live responsible lives, but not enough to alter our lifestyles. We want enough of God to say grace over our meals, but not enough to help feed the starving people around the world. We just want a touch of God. We want God to be there when we need him, but we don't want him dictating in our lives. It reminds me of where our society is going today. Whatever you think of this, that's up to you, but you'll know my thoughts when I'm done. Society wants to compare Henry Potter to Jesus. On Channel 4, TV news, that's who they compared Harry Potter to, was to Jesus and to his life here on earth. How warped our thinking has become. And in doing so, we say what the Bible warns us against, and that is that we are not to mess around with those who practice wizardry, those who practice demonship, but we're to clear ourselves of such people and stay clear of anything that has to do with such teaching. And yet our world is wanting to compare this new, and people are going crazy. I believe it is now top to sales of the Bible. Just in a few days, Harry Potter's books. And you know, the worst of it is that it's filled with wizardry. I know people are listening to me all over Greene County. But I'll say it one more time. How much of God are we allowing in our lives? Do we just want him on the shelf when we need him so that we can enjoy any old thing we want to enjoy and we can practice sin whenever we want to and then come back to him and he says, I'll justify it. I'll say okay to you. I want you, God, to know that God is not that kind of God. He's a God of love, but he's a God of holy love. Not of folk love. Let me explain that to you. You see, there is a great gulf between the God of the Bible and the God of modern folk religion. The God of folk religion is seen as a God of sentimental love rather than holy love. He is viewed as the man upstairs. How many can confirm that? He is viewed as a man upstairs who is approached as an indulgent, permissive father who demands nothing and expects nothing from his people. But that's exactly the opposite of what I find in the God that I serve. Notice in my text in Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 22 and 23. Fear ye not me, saith the Lord. Will ye not tremble at my presence, which hath placed the sand for the bound of the sea by a perpetual decree, that it cannot pass it, and though the waves thereof toss themselves, yet can they not prevail. Though they roar, yet can they not pass over it. But this people hath a revolting and a rebellious heart. They are revolted, and they have gone, and I paraphrase, and they have gone far away from that which I have taught them, and where I've asked them to walk. Point number one. Jeremiah chapter 5, there was a law, there was a lack of reverence. Number two, there was a loss of righteous consciousness. This is not quite, I'll explain this. This is not quite conviction, like we know the Holy Spirit convicts us. It sort of borders on that. Righteous consciousness is when self-will challenges divine authority of God. There is always a loss of this. A look what we've done instead of look what God has done. It prevails in our society today. We've lost the conviction of who God is and what our relationship is with Him. And anything that is done around us or through us, we want the credit for it instead of God wanting the credit. So what has happened is we've lost the conviction of God. We've lost the fact of who God is and who should get the glory for everything. Ladies and gentlemen, He should get the glory for everything. Not just a few things. He should get the glory for everything. You know, I can't come in church. I preached last Sunday. I can't come in church and lift my hands and glorify Jesus and make a loud noise before Him and then walk out and go back to my sin. It's not valid. If that happens, then that becomes my will against God's authority. And it will not work. Then my praise becomes void and becomes empty. People shut up their hearts and shun compassion for others and start looking out for number one. I remember in my main text this morning in Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 1, run ye to and fro through the streets of Jerusalem and see now and know and seek in the broad places thereof if you can find a man, if there be any that executeth judgment, that seeketh the truth, I will pardon it, or I will pardon them. Here the prophet was challenged to find one man who actually executed justice and sought for truth. He was challenged to find one who had a right relationship with God and cared about his fellow man. He sought among the poor, but he couldn't find anybody. He found even among the poor that they were selfish and that they wanted people to help them. And every time they turned to the left or the right, they didn't do anything for themselves. They wanted other people to supply for them and do for them. And thus, they never had to raise their own hand to provide for their own family. They expected other people to supply money and food for them. There's a limit, you know. We have a needy family fund in our church, and we try to be as open and gracious as we can with that fund, not only in our own church, but with people in the community. But we find that there are people that will take advantage of it, and they'll call and they'll lie to us week after week and give us. I've had people lie to me and say, I've got cancer. I'm dying of cancer. They didn't have any more cancer than that pew. But because they thought they could get to me and get some money to buy what I don't know, they would lie a different lie every week. And so I said, Lord, you reveal to me and show me who these people are and my secretary and those who are in the office so we understand. And so the Lord caused them to start going back and messing around with the lie they first told. They forgot that I remembered. Now you see, there are people in need, and then there are people that will use God. Everybody with me? That's what Jeremiah was finding. He was finding even the poor. They were only worried about themselves. They weren't worried about who God was. They weren't worried about what God could do for them. He found none among the priests. He couldn't go to the priests and find anybody who still had faith in God. Ladies and gentlemen, I know this sounds like a message of doom, but we need to wake up and smell the roses. People are going to church all around the world, and they're not hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ. They're sitting in the pew, and they're hearing everything but the gospel. When we come to church, the least the people ought to expect is to be able to worship God in spirit and in truth. And secondly, to hear the unadulterated Word of God. Jeremiah went to the pagans, and he couldn't find anybody there that had faith in God. There is an evidence of that today. Human life is disregarded by abortion on demand. God help our society to quit killing babies. There's child abuse and child pornography, and it's rampant everywhere. Children, this moment, are being used. For the name of pornography, so that some crazy individual can have their fleshly desires fed. Sin is winked at by religious leaders. Thousands die each year because of drunk drivers. And yet there are commercials on TV by Budweiser that says, "We are your friend. Trust in us. We are your friend." And thousands this year will die because of somebody under the influence of alcohol. There was a pastor in a very well-known Bible church, one that taught the Word of God, one that lived the Word of God and had a conviction about who God was and what he felt about God. Today, he is a denier of the deity of Jesus. He is a professor at USC and one who does everything he can to turn young people away from Christianity. He also falls into the category of an apostate, somebody who knows the truth and has all the information about the truth, but willingly and willfully turns his back on the truth for his own pursuits. People are doing that today. There are even so-called religious places of Bible education where you could go in believing in God and come out not. You see, what am I saying this morning? Ladies and gentlemen, until God is given his rightful place in our society, we will continue to see a disregard for truth and a disregard for justice, and we will wink at it and let it be. How many believe the church ought to stand up and be heard? I believe it should. I believe that we have a responsibility in Greene County and all around our constituency, Monongalia County, Preston County, all the counties that somewhat get close to surrounding us. We have a responsibility to these people to preach the truth and to share the truth. Okay. We have shared with you this morning from this text some important facts. And I want to close with this. Number three. There was a disassociation of the gift from the giver. Let me say that again. There was a disassociation of the gift from the giver. Jeremiah chapter 5 and verse 24. Neither say they in their hearts, "Let us now fear the Lord our God that giveth rain, both the former and the latter, in his season. He reserves unto us the appointed weeks of the harvest." You see, what the scripture is saying and what I'm saying in point number three, no longer is it God that supplies our needs. We supply them. But the Bible warns us in these last days to look out for certain types of individuals. And I'd like to read it to you, again reading from the King James Version. And you judge in your own heart how valid this scripture is when you look at today. Chapter 3 of 2 Timothy, verses 1 through 5. This know also that in the last days, perilous times, dangerous times shall come. For men shall be lovers of their own selves. Tummy tucks, face tucks, all kinds of tucks, additions, anything to make us prettier and worth more. And yet, I forget what we're worth. It's not very much in dollars and cents. Men shall be lovers of their own selves. Covetous, boasters, proud, blasphemers, disobedient to parents, unthankful, unholy, without natural affection, homosexuality, lesbianism, truce breakers, accusers, incompetent, fierce, despisers of those that are good, traitors, heady, high-minded. Notice this, lovers of pleasure more than lovers of God. What does Paul say in this second letter to young Timothy that was getting ready to take his place and begin to evangelize in Paul's place and pastor? He sums it up in verse 5. These people have a form of godliness, but deny the power thereof. And then he ended, from such people, turn away. Don't have any association with such people. You know what the church has done? The church has tried to mold ourselves accordingly with them. And it's destroying what the church stands for and who the church really is. God help us that we will not allow self-will to deny the authority of God. Galatians chapter 3 and verse 3 says, it's really a powerful scripture. Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit, how many remember that when you were saved, the Holy Spirit drew you? And then after you were saved, the Holy Spirit took up residence in you? How many believes that? I'm not talking about the baptism of the Holy Spirit now with the evidence of tongues. I'm talking about when you become a believer, a born-again Christian. The Bible says that the Spirit of God takes up residence in you. Amen. Well, that's what this scripture is saying. It's saying, what has happened to the church? Paul was speaking here to the church of Galatia. He wasn't talking to the world. He wasn't talking to unbelievers. He was talking to the church. And he said, church, wake up. Are you so foolish? Having begun in the Spirit through your born-again experience, and ye are now made perfect by the flesh? Have you left the Spirit of God and the Word of God and what it stands for, and now follow after the flesh and after the devil? God help us. God help us to wake up. Church, help us to wake up before it's too late. Just because we go to church doesn't mean we'll go to heaven. You can go to church every Sunday and still land in hell. There's only one way to be saved. I don't care what they preach. There's only one way to be saved, and that is to believe on Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for my sins and to cleanse me from all unrighteousness. Without that, I will not be ready when the rapture takes place. No longer is it God that supplies our needs. We supply them. Most people today want to feel that they are in charge. I think to a certain extent all of us do. We like to know we're in charge. The last thing they want is the preacher to disturb them. A pastor told me not long ago, and I know it's different in the city area than it is here around Greene County and around Morgantown. These are small towns compared to big metropolitan areas. But he told me, he said he moved from a country church to a city church, and he said a note was passed to him the first Sunday morning that he got in the pulpit, because somebody heard that he liked to visit his parishioners and he liked to visit the hospitals, and if anybody was sick, he would go visit them at their home, or at least try to call them and try to keep up with them. And this note was handed to the pastor and said, please read it and then read it out loud. First part was, we do not want you visiting us. Now, pastor, we want you to say this from the pulpit. I will not visit you. That was the very first service he ever had in the church. And that's how he started out the service. They fired me after 1 week. You see, that's how society is today. Preacher, we can tolerate you for 1 hour. We can sit in church and listen to you yell. But don't you come to our doorstep. Don't you call us on the phone. Don't you bother us. For when we walk out of this church, our time is our own. Thank you. How many understand what I'm talking about? You see, this is the era of time that we're living in. Now, I understand everybody has private lives. I wouldn't want people at my doorstep 8 hours a day coming to visit me. I'd have no time to listen to my wife talk. All the things that she wants done and all the things we're going to do, and just sit there and enjoy one another. Yeah. The last thing I want is for the preacher to disturb them. Go back to our text. In Jeremiah chapter 5, verses 30 and 31. Here's a wonderful and horrible thing that is being committed in the land. The prophets, the preachers, prophesy, but they prophesy falsely. And the priests bear rule by their means. And my people love to have it that way. That's scary. Did you hear that? The colder, the less spiritual the preacher is, if he doesn't, I'm not saying you people are like that, I know you're not, but you know, folks, I probably, if I went to some churches, I wouldn't last long, because I sometimes stomp on our toes. And people wouldn't tolerate that. But I'll tell you, folks, all they want is somebody to stand up there and give a pretty sermon and smile at them when they go home and say, you're good. Be here next Sunday, you'll get another dose. And everything will be all right. But God said, by Jeremiah, he said, the preachers prophesy falsely. They have no touch of God in their lives. And the people love it that way. God, help us today. I close with this. May God never let us forget what we were without Him. Mr., all good and perfect gifts come from Him. I don't care what they say. All good and perfect gifts come from Him. A story is told of a man who was resisting the cost of oats that he fed to his mule. So he decided to gradually substitute sawdust in the diet. Everything went well for a while, but by the time the mule was satisfied with the sawdust, he died. The same is true spiritually. The changeover from truth to error, listen to me, the changeover from truth to error is a slow process, and the people don't always know the difference. But before you know it, they're all dead. Folks, I'd just like to say it in West Virginia terms. Let's wake up. Church, let's wake up. My mom used to say, smell the roses while you can. And that's what this message talks about today. Folks, let's wake up and smell the roses while we can. Let's not think about sending them to Jesus after we're gone. It's too late then. It's too late. Jeremiah's solemn warning to this, in closing, you can deny God's right in your life. You can close Him out if you choose. You can hold Him at arm's length if you wish. But what will you do in the end? For all of us here on this floor and in the balcony, when all that you have accomplished falls down around you, when your family disintegrates and your sons and your daughters defiantly shake their fists in your face and in God's face, when all hell breaks loose and the devil and his imps run rampant over this earth, when you stand in the presence of the Almighty God, what will you do when you finally see that the Word of God is true and that Satan is a liar and that God is the solemn ruler of all the universe? Then you will join all those. If you fail to see it till then, you will join all those who will be forced to kneel on their knees before God and say, holy, 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 Lord God, omnipotent reigneth. But will it be too late then? You see, there's coming a day when every knee shall bow and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. And it says that every man and every woman from every faith, from every background, from every belief, from every following of hell will have to bow and confirm that He is God. But it will not save them. Did you hear me this morning? It will not save them. They'll still be lost without God. Would you stand with me? Just before we pray this morning, would you sing this with me? I'll wait till Joy gets up there and some of the kids. Notice I called some of them kids, and you're not. There's a song in your songbook. I won't sing it all, but 354 that says, where could I go but to the Lord? This morning, that's what this sermon's all about. Where could I go but to the Lord? If you know it, sing it the first verse with me. Okay?
Living you are in the sun.
Let's go.
comfort us, even we that have been away for many years. Turn us away from the flesh and the desires of the flesh. And help us in these last days when sin is so rampant, and when the world has turned away from God and has went her own way. I pray this morning that this church in Mount Morris, Pennsylvania, will make the decision to follow the Lord Jesus Christ. We will follow you. We'll walk with you. We'll let go of sin. We'll let go of lust, the flesh, and the devil. And Lord, we'll make a decision to follow you with all of our hearts, all of our souls, all of our spirits, all of our might. Jesus will pay the price, whatever it is, to say, I'm going all the way with the Lord, all the way with Jesus. I don't care which way the others go. I don't care what my family says. I've made a decision to walk with God, and I'm going with Him all the way. Hallelujah. Have your way in this place this morning. Anoint us, Jesus, as we worship you, as we make decisions, Lord, before you at this altar. Help us, God. Help those in the congregation. God, help every family represented here today to say, I will not follow the ways of hell, but I'm going to walk with God. I don't care what they think of me. I'm going to walk with God, and I'm going to be ready when that rapture comes, when that trumpet blows, when Jesus appears in the clouds of glory. I'm going to be ready. Where could I go but to the Lord? Hallelujah.